It is my pleasure and honor to introduce Peter Costello's lecture on givenness and explication in key biblical texts. So it's a phenomenological reading of Husserl. And I want to thank Peter very much for, this is our actually first special lecture at the Society for the Phenomenology of Religious Experience. So it's very exciting to have you, and I'm passing it to you now. Please tell us your thoughts.
Thank you, Olga, for the opportunity. Thank you for everyone for coming. I think, Olga, you're putting this up somewhere, perhaps on YouTube later, so if people need to leave early, it will be recorded, and that's fine. Like, you don't have to stay, especially Chrissy and Annie, who have other things to do. But I appreciate all of you being here. I'm going to talk for about an hour, hour and 15 minutes on the lecture on Husserl and the Bible, and then hopefully people will feel like they can ask questions afterwards. Mm-hmm. And so if you can, make sure that your mute button is on so we don't have feedback until the question period. In this lecture, I present Husserl's thought as a kind of hospitality, both to the text and to the object and other person within experience. How's this sound? Does this sound okay? Everyone can hear?
It sounds very well, yeah. Very good sound.
In doing so, I take Derrida's treatment of hospitality to be a guide. For Derrida still defines hospitality, like Husserl might do, in a quasi-transcendental way. That is, as still holding itself to be in part unconditional, absolute, or methodical. But of course, a relation to the transcendental is not all that hospitality or that phenomenology is or presents. Hospitality, like phenomenology, must be unconditional and at the same time, something palpable, conditioned, and responsive. Something coming from and open to the other person in the moment and manner of her appearance. And so, as Derrida claims, we must keep any transcendental character of hospitality, or perhaps any transcendental character of phenomenology, quote, with some reservations under erasure, if you like, or under epoche. Derrida refer to the epoche here in rendering what ought to be, what must be, hospitality. Why must the metaphysical assumptions of the transcendental law, of transcendental phenomenological law, be bracketed? The epoche surfaces for Derrida because hospitality is not just a pre-given eidetic law of conduct. Rather, the manner in which the other person is given to me entails that I am never fully prepared to be hospitable. Instead, I must also, at the same time as I respond dutifully, recognize that hospitality is, as Derrida notes, quote, invented for the singularity of the new arrival, of the unexpected visitor. So the new arrival, the visitor, the foreigner, who comes and seeks shelter under our roof, this singular person demands both the clarity of the unconditional and the messiness of singular responses. Like phenomenological constitution for Husserl, hospitality is both a description of the given as given and a description of the given as surpassing itself, developing itself towards a horizon that is only at best sketched out. And so if we want to read Derrida and Husserl together, as I think we should, then we're forced as good phenomenologists, of which Derrida is one, to give hospitality, to perform phenomenology in multiple ways at the same time, as if under an a priori law, and as if within an a posteriori response. So in this lecture, I offer two main parts to a description of Husserlian phenomenology as a hospitable way of reading sacred texts from the Bible. In the first part, and it's the longer part, I'm going to discuss three main themes in Husserl's work. In the second, I'll embed the discussion of Husserl and terminology previously discussed within my hermeneutics of some texts from Jewish and Christian scripture. It's my hope that allowing Husserl to open up these sacred texts can show how phenomenology itself is successful and creative when it moves toward the margins of human experience. My main argument will be political. I will be claiming, perhaps implicitly, but nevertheless strongly, that Husserlian phenomenology demands that we fashion our political and religious lives as an echo of the very motion of human experience, as a kind of hospitality towards those who inhabit the margins of experience. So now I'm on the first longer part. In the first volume of The Ideas, Husserl presents the practice of phenomenology as about three things. First, it's about returning to and making a beginning, an absolute beginning, with respect to how we structure our description of experience. Second, it's about recognizing our situation of involvement with what is given as we begin to describe its givenness. And third, phenomenology is about our attempt within our now ongoing description to extend a bodily movement of reciprocity, a reverberation, towards the horizon of what appears and towards the other person and the origin of givenness. Phenomenology is, to say it again, about three things: making an absolute beginning, recognizing our situation of involvement, and extending our movements. So let's look at each of these. And I want to take as a salient passage one from section 24 of his first volume of Ideas. It's where he gives us the principle of all principles. And no doubt many of you remember and could recite this from memory, but I want to actually read it with some shifts in Fred Kirsten's translation. So I'm just going to read the quote from section 24 about the principle of all principles. That every originarily giving intuition is a legitimizing source of cognition, that everything that originarily presents itself to us, so to speak, in its bodily actuality, leibhaft in Wirklichkeit, is to be accepted simply as what it gives itself to be, but also only within the limits in which it is gives itself there. Every statement that does no more than lend expression to such givennesses by simple explication, bloße explicatione, and by means of carefully measured significations, is actually an absolute beginning, called upon to serve as a foundation. So that's the quote from section 24. So Husserl's principle of all principles is a beginning in three ways. First, it's a beginning by virtue of calling attention to the way in which intuition or perception works in our lived experience. Perception does not fill in the pre-existing a priori skeleton of concepts. Rather, perception acts, gives, in an original way. Perception is the intertwining of subject and object, is the legitimizing source for knowledge or cognition. When we see this, we realize that for Husserl, we don't begin with concepts and end with perception. We begin with perception and see that our concepts, if they are legitimate ones, arise out of and answer to the entwined structure of perception. Perception, because it is the situation in which the bodily reality of the thing calls upon our lived body, is always building concepts within itself, generating them within the very act of opening itself toward the thing that it grasps. In fact, Husserl alludes to this earlier in the Ideas when he says, we do not presuppose, quote, even the concept of philosophy when we begin phenomenology. How do you not presuppose concepts? By allowing perception to do its own generative work. That's the first way it's a beginning. The second way this principle of all principles is a beginning is in the way that it allows us to consider how the act of giving is located just as essentially in the thing itself, the thing perceived, as in the perceiver. The principle shows us how giving within the situation of perception is dual, reciprocal, entwined, and bodily. For the appearance of the thing that we intuit is initiated not only, not fully, by us, not even by a passive synthesis of hyletic data. Rather, the appearance of the thing is initiated equally and essentially by that thing itself. Within the situation of perception, the thing presents itself, gives itself in its flesh or bodily actuality. The thing gives itself by already having made its body, its flesh, as relevant to our own flesh. The thing gives because the formation of the situation of being with things has cast itself backwards in intuition before either of us existed for the other. The thing acts because we are immersed in something that has a larger role than either of us on our own. How else can we explain the way in which we come to see the possibility of adjusting our perceptions to the limits of the self-givenness of the thing? We can find the limits that we see erected for our description, the limits that form our phenomenological imperative of acceptance. We can find that those limits are the limits of the thing's action, because this whole process of mutual involvement has predated our phenomenological reflection and explication. The situation of perception, then, is the mutual giving of our limits to one another, both the thing and we ourselves. And it is by means of this dual manifestation of gifted limits that each can act upon the other from within itself, me and the thing acting on each other. The situation of perception, then, is simply our discovering the limits of things as relevant to ourselves. Perception is our bringing those limits to light by attending to the intrinsic mutuality of the work of givenness. So neither our concepts nor our intuition give the law to a chaos of data that impinges upon us. There is no chaos. There are no data. Perception does not entail our ability unilaterally to collect or impose. Perception is both personal and pre-personal, active and originarily given to itself, sensible and open, by being thoroughly and immediately involved within a reciprocal motion of acts of giving. So let's dwell on this a bit more, as it will serve to highlight how the foreigner or the immigrant and the need for hospitality inhabit phenomenology from the very beginning. Perception, intuition, gives something to be relevant, meaningful in its own action. In that sense, perception is originary, and perception in me as me claims the right to be considered the main actor. My perception, my act, demands the right to first recognition or first refusal, as it were. In this sense, my act of perception is not a host, we're talking about hospitality, but a lord. But within that originary act of perception, there is a simultaneous and immediate resignation to the thing. For the act of perception is the act of giving meaning to the way in which the thing has always already given itself to us by means of making a claim on our flesh. So perception seems to be a lord, but it's not a lord, but a host, and a rather surprised host. Its power is maintained only by means of its ability to subject itself, to be a subject, to the thing. Perception in being originary is thus also not simply original. Rather, perception is, in its power, given over to recognizing not only the thing's reflection of our own flesh, but also the way in which the thing sets itself up by means of that reflection as not immediately our active intuition. The thing sets itself up as maintaining itself outside our control. So our intuition, for all its originary host-like character, given to itself as a process of following the thing, of welcoming it, sketching its givenness as the origin and point of perception's own initiative. And what do we notice, we phenomenologists, who pursue this simultaneity of power and submission? We notice that this originary yet subordinate act of intuition must, to be phenomenological, agree to follow the thing, all the while knowing it was to us that the thing addressed itself. It was to our intuition, which the thing itself does not manifest except passively, by implication, that it, the thing, appealed. For surely the thing has not, and Husserl has not said it has anyway, surely the thing has not seen or perceived us. The thing has not fixed us with its perceiving gaze, not even with the blue of its color or the height of its majesty. Yet the thing has announced its very body as an echo of our own. The thing has therefore appeared both to have seen and not to have seen us. We can never be sure, then, that we have not been previewed by that very blue or that very height as the intuiting meaning givers that we are. In this sense, then, the sense of being previewed by the thing, we are answering to the margin of our perception. And we hold in some strange, treasured way the peripheral recognition that the thing has just as much enabled this new situation of phenomenology. This situation, the one that Husserl calls constitution, is both the institution and destitution of us as actors. That was the first beginning. The second beginning in that little quote from section 24 is a beginning that expands our very notion of simultaneity, of situation, as joining power and subservience. We are, we exist, a simultaneity of being addressed and of addressing, and each by means of the other. Then there is a third kind of beginning, the beginning not of intuitive act or of thingly act, but of what Husserl calls simple explication. Out of our situation of mutual involvement with what we intuit, we inaugurate some new process. We write it down. We describe the thing in its givenness and in our co-givenness with it. We begin, to return to the quote from section 24, by doing no more than what Husserl says is lending expression. We are creditors, crediting the thing in its relation to us with an expression. And this expression serves as an absolute beginning. But a beginning for what? Can every statement be an absolute beginning? Every single one? How will we find the terms for a simple explication? Again, the thing, it would seem, is at least half in charge. The thing will, in our mutual bodily situation, lead us to see its appropriateness for the language that we would lend it. The thing must be willing to take on the debt for this credit. It must answer to the creditor and be willing to take the stand as the surety for its loan. The credit is a beginning insofar as it extends itself on its own power to others. Our credit makes them rich too. The thing's givenness expands, travels, pursues a further way of displaying itself in its intertwining with us. Remember that the thing has announced itself in its flesh to ours. It speaks, but not without us. It makes claims, but only in sketches, in references, in the concentrated cry that perception would be, can be, and often is. We lend a voice to the thing because it has announced itself as something that would speak to us. So we lend it expression, and we follow up what it has to say on the basis of our credit. Simple explication, then, is something not pre-given, but rather continuously giving both itself and the thing in their co-committed significance. Phenomenology works, then, by making a beginning each time that opens us onto the absolute. You can read God here, onto a trajectory that neither we nor the thing close off once we begin together. Explication, each statement becomes a foundation. The concept, the principle, as Husserl calls it, does not lie within each statement such that we simply need to cut it out. The concept is the statement. The explication begins and continues the situation of co-givenness, of mutual reverberation that the thing and we have entered into, perhaps even unwillingly, by means of our porousness. How's it going so far? Is the tone and the pace okay?
Yeah.
All right. So now I'm going to show you three selections from formal and transcendental logic, Cartesian meditations, and crisis of the European sciences. And I'm going to show this in order to move towards the margins. So we're going to go from simple explication to the margins. In Formal and Transcendental Logic, it's another book of Husserl's, Husserl's main goal is to show how any examination of the rules and functions of logical formations involve a self-explication of the transcendental subjectivity that we each are. As part of that self-explication, Husserl shows that even in occasional judgments, we display a transcendental structure that allows us to think that we have something to say to ourselves and others within a shared situation. rooted in our self-experience of what he calls normality, we experience our power to say things, quote, by the very fact of being normal. And that means that we can engage in the ability to make statements relevant to others within this situation by means of having at our normal disposal, quote, the situational horizons belonging to it and common to all. But the experience of normality is not itself sufficiently transcendental to guarantee our ability to make any judgments, even occasional ones. And so Husserl shows that the experience of normality and our groundedness in a shared situation is due to, quote, the constituting horizon intentionality, without which the surrounding world of daily life would not be an experienced world. And it's always prior to its explication by someone who reflects, end quote. The horizon intentionality is prior to explication, prior to reflection, prior to normality. This is quite important for us because it entails that we are oriented by means of our act of intending the horizon to the whole world, the whole of the situation, by means of our perspective, our placement. Our ability in normal life to make occasional judgments then depends on the experience of an entirety of the situation of normality only within a much richer experience. Normality is secondary. Openness to the absolute upsurge of non-occasionality, of overwhelming excess, of the throng pressing towards us in its unmediated weight, this is primary. Before we even explicate the world, before we can judge it or separate it into normal and abnormal, stranger or familiar, we are engaged in an act of intentionality that precedes even its own explication. We are pre-predicatively over into the totality of references on the other sides of things in the past and future of the course of this experience happening within these limits of this situation. We are already on the margins of normality and abnormality. We are, to implicate Heidegger's term, constantly and overwhelmingly ecstatic in our intentionality. And this means that what we do in explication, in reflection, in articulating judgments about our situation, is always to emerge from our dispersion back to a center that would lend expression to where we have already been. We are within the very life of the situation before we recognize that. To work with normality within the context of judgment is to admit that, even if only implicitly, as such normal judgers, we must always already have traveled away from explication in order to motivate explication. As Husserl moves further into our self-explication as transcendental subjectivity in formal and transcendental logic, he begins to talk about experience, and the word that I'm translating experience here is Erfahrung. And he talks about Erfahrung and transcendental intersubjectivity as intentionalities in their own right. We do not give the law to experience, so to say. Experience gives the law and gives things to us. We participate in experience and come towards ourselves from out of it. So I'm going to turn, and most of you have a handout, and on the handout is the second set of quotes from the formal and transcendental logic. The first three are about experience, and the next two are about intersubjectivity. I'm just going to read them, and I know it's a bit to read, but I want you to listen to how he talks about experience and intersubjectivity. And again, the word for experience here is Erfahrung. Experience is not an opening through which a world existing prior to all experience shines into a room of consciousness. It is not a mere taking of something alien to consciousness into consciousness. Experience is the performance in which, for me, the experiencer, the experienced being, is there, and is there as what it is, with the whole content and the mode of being that experience itself, by the performance going on in its intentionality, attributes to it. Experience is what tells me here. I have experience of myself with primary originality, of others with a merely secondary originality. This intersubject, that was experience. This intersubjectivity, new quote, according to its sense, also exists mutatis mutandis in itself and for itself, with the mode of existence that belongs to something absolute. An absolute existent, like intersubjectivity, is existent in the form an intentional life, which no matter what else it may be intrinsically conscious of, is at the same time consciousness of itself. Likewise, as a transcendental ego, I find myself as determined from the outside. It is obvious that transcendentally speaking, I can be conditioned by something external, by something that goes beyond my self-contained ownness, only if it has the sense someone else, andere, and in a thoroughly understandable manner gains and legitimates in me its acceptance as being another transcendental ego. All right, so that was three quotes on experience and two on intersubjectivity. And now I'm going to read you what I think about those quotes. Experience, erfahrung, acts. It tells me. It says. Husserl repeats this fact of experience speaking three times in section 94. Experience tells me things. It expresses. Experience is thus mine, yet not entirely mine. If experience were simply and utterly mine, it would not need to speak. But it does speak. And thus, when we search for the simple explication to lend to what appears, we have a resource. We have a source. The words are first spoken by experience to us. We are given by a source that blends itself with our lived experience or Erlebnis. Erfahrung names our involvement with our whole intentional life, with that power in us that we are, that performs, speaks, and lends expression. Our lived experience, our Erlebnis, thus has an ally that orients it towards predication, towards the clarification and continuation of its givenness. Erfahrung experience is not a simple taking in of the alien. It cannot be, since the other who is inaccessible to me remains alien. Experience is not a taking in, but rather a performance by which inside and outside are forever paired and referred to each other. Erfahrung performs some mysterious change by which I am where the thing is. I am alive. I grasp its is there. I am towards the things as what it is. This Erfahrung is not for the faint at heart, the shrinking violet who remains indoors. This is for the person who is moved by a performance, moved outside of herself toward the stage that she has been agreeing to sit by means of performing her role of sitting in the audience. Where am I in the middle of this performance of Erfahrung? I'm not in my chair, or I am in my chair only in moments of discomfort, when the performance does not take me up and into itself. When I am immersed in the performance of experience, as I usually am, I follow experience. I live through it, Erlebnis. And yet what I follow experience towards is something other than myself. I follow it through the process by which I too, I alone, both linguistic formulations are correct, I too, I alone, have come to pursue the other within myself, myself outside myself, the other outside myself, all three. In short, by means of Erfahrung, I begin to live through Erleben. As living, as experiencing, I am also wrapped up or folded into intersubjectivity. This too has an in itself and a for itself, both at the same time, and is a unity that acts, that enacts, just as Erfahrung does. Intersubjectivity is an absolute existent. It lives an intentionality. And thus it, like experience, is both mine and not mine. It lives itself in me and as me. And I am conscious of myself in it and of it in me. All my consciousness is intersubjective, and all intersubjectivity is my consciousness. And yet, for all that intimacy, for all that identification, Intersubjectivity is not just simply me, just as Erfahrung was not. Intersubjectivity is a life I participate in as paired with others, as given over to them. Intersubjectivity is what I live as the way in which I am, quote, determined from the outside. To be an intersubjective subject, the other person has already done her work on me. It is thoroughly understandable, he says, how she has done so, for she announces herself as outside of me and has herself, quote, gained and legitimated my experience of her by constantly proving both her experienceability and her distance from me. She proves my experience of her by not falling apart into moments of intimacy and moments of distance. She proves the unity of my experience of her and our experience together by maintaining the very truth of my experience of her, that she is not simply in my experience, that I have not simply taken her in, but that she remains external to me, determining me from without and from within. I am intersubjectivity then by means of being able to experience myself within a logic of inside and outside that no longer moves back and forth from one to the other. I am intersubjectivity by means of living the simultaneity and mutuality of inside and outside. What I am, for Husserl, is an experiencer who is always oriented toward the outside by way of the inside. I am always toward the margins on which the other or alien determines me, wins me over, resists me, compels me to grant them meaning. I am not consciousness by means of being here, being I only. I am consciousness insofar as home and beyond no longer stand apart. I am consciousness only by means of being with the other and decentering myself so that I can have a center by means of her. I am experience by way of living through the call of the larger enterprise, experience or intersubjectivity, that does its work in me. And this means not that I make sense of the other by means of myself, but that I become other to myself and thus come to myself by explication or talking or writing. Only because I do in fact have the capacity to make some sense of the other over there where the other is, and because it is thoroughly understandable to me that I must do so. But of course, following the principle of all principles, I can make sense of the other only within the limits she gives. And thus we must continuously pursue one another through simple explication. This will mean that we continue to view the experience of the alien other person, quote, as existing an index for a system of uncoverable constitutive performances. But because the index is not that for the thing, but is for a shared noetic system of performances, the index that the other offers is not the unfolding of a pre-given, pre-sketched list of noetic acts of the other and myself, but rather is an index as, quote, the most extreme radicalness in striving to uproot all prejudice. We still move within simple explication, in other words, because the thorough understandability of the alien other person calls precisely for the ongoing work of lending expression to one another, such that the very borders between initiative and submission, creation and rendition, fade into a new, more powerful unity. So we've discussed Husserl's account of the absolute beginning that simple explication represents, and we've shown how experience and intersubjectivity are the kinds of unities that demand simple explication by virtue of their active and absolute character. So now let's think about how we can make an absolute beginning by way of the absolute existence of our togetherness. To this end, I would like to share some final passages from the Cartesian Meditations in the Crisis, and then we're going to turn to the Bible. I know you think this was all like a ploy for me to talk about Husserl and not actually get to the Bible. We're going to get to the Bible. Okay? In the Cartesian Meditations, and now this is the third set of quotes on the handout that I hope some of you have. Husserl describes the way that our noetic acts, our intending, mean more than what is adequately or actually on hand. We are able to intend beyond what we intend. Here's the quote. This intending beyond itself, which is implicit in any consciousness, must be considered an essential moment of it. That, on the other hand, this intending is and must be a meaning more of the same, becomes shown only by the evidence of a possible making distinct and ultimately of an intuitive uncovering in the form of actual and possible continued perceiving, fortwahrnehmens, or if possible recollecting as something to be done on my initiative. So now I'm going to move on to talk about that. In each act of consciousness, we intend beyond ourselves. Our intending leaps ahead of us by means of the commonality and alterity that each experienced unity claims. Each thing claims to resonate with our flesh, to be there in the flesh as it presents itself. Each thing reserves itself to itself as other by means of the necessity we experience within the beyond of our own intending. The thing means more than we explicitly take it to mean. And this happens essentially by way of the thing's self-presentation. This means that the thing has already engaged our future and past acts here in the present moment of perception. The thing has already dispersed us and brought us together, and it has done so in the very moment of our explicit perception of it. The thing then is perceived as thing, the other person perceived as other, because of the fort within the da, because of the way in which the beyond of the thing is activated within the very moment of intending. I perceive a thing, a person, in short, because its appearance is a motivation toward the margin of the present encounter, erfahrung. I say towards the margin because it is clear that for Husserl, there can be only margins. There is no outside of consciousness, no outside of subjectivity. He says, if transcendental subjectivity is the universe of possible sense, this is him now, then an outside is precisely nonsense. But even nonsense is always a mode of sense and has its nonsensicalness within the sphere of possible insight. That's the end of the short quote. The senses outside and inside are neither pre-given, nor static, nor simple. These two senses are not given to experience from an a priori law that remains distinct from consciousness. Rather, outside and inside gather their sense from our subjectivity, from the meaning of our perception. There are too many meanings to outside and inside, and each new experience presents another one, just as each new person does. All these unique meanings of inside and outside demand to be rooted in simultaneity and Ursprung, or origin, of inside and outside in the transcendental. This all means for Husserl, we do not reside either inside or outside of ourselves when we experience. On the contrary, we can only travel to and within the margin, because it is here that we can dwell coherently without prejudice, according to simple explication that is neither submission nor creation. We must, as Husserl is fond of saying, perform a zigzag or a parallel explication of noesis and noema as phenomenologists. And this means that where we live is marginal within the life world as both our origin and our constitution. To the extent that we can formulate the senses of outside and inside, then, in terms of sense anyway, we can explicate them as pointing toward a living, pre-predicative, simultaneous situation of involvement. We live these senses of inside and outside, then, only by means of relying on our passive lived experience on the margin, within their intertwining, before they come to be distinguished. Any other sense of inside and outside, any carving out of what belongs and what does not belong, normal and abnormal, stranger and familiar, any sense to outside and inside other than one of their meaningful simultaneity appears as secondary to the transcendental sense. That is not to say, of course, that the nonsense of our current political lives are possible an actual marginalization and rejection of other people based on their geography or their language or their skin color. It's not to say that this does not have a sense to it. Sadly, we know that such rejections make too much sense. The suffering they cause is proof of their sense. But what is the reason that these acts make sense? The reason I see it is this: the contemporary political effort we make to place others on the margins reveals what it is that each and all of us have always already lived, namely an intentional life in which every event with significance, every event, invokes and remains oriented firmly within consciousness as the margin that is both within and without. By marginalizing other people in contemporary political society, we simply make a hollow, poorly understood imitation of what we in some sense know has always already been the very essence of our intentional life. In other words, the essence of our lives as meaning givers is to be on the margins. And what we are, we can accomplish concretely in a host of possible ways. We marginalize others because intentional life is marginal. Marginalization in the political sense is therefore, I would claim, our natural attitude, psychological manner of fleeing, and thus of reinstituting a transcendental truth. We flee it as the truth of each of us by forming a prejudice that only some and not we must live there. We form a crisis, Western in origin, by doing this. But this does not stop us from denying that if any are forced on the margins, we too are so forced. But we have given up perceiving by means of simple explication of the presentation of the limits of things as they present themselves. We perceive as if we are alone in the natural attitude, and as if we could self-direct the explication. It's only if we take the margin, the limit, the appearance of the other as herself there, as essential, only if this marginality is perceived to be the essence of consciousness as always intending beyond itself, only thereby can we understand the character of our own subjectivity as not having an outside. Only thereby can we adjust our political lives to fit our perceptual ones. For Husserl, there is no outside to what cannot erect walls. There is no outside to a life of consciousness engaged together in the process of intertwining with the flesh of things and with the alienness of others and of events. There is no outside to a life of giving, receiving, accepting, and explicating meaning. For through all of Husserl's work, it seems to me that it is meaning that pulls us out of ourselves toward the thing. Meaning is the life we share with things. Meaning pulls the thing toward us. Meaning gives the thing its agency. Meaning gives us our initiative. Meaning is the process by which all that is marginal continues to be marginal, uncovered, concealed, revealed, rehearsed, readdressed. If we mean more than we are aware, and we always do, if we are always coming back home to our own powers, to our own process, to our own experience, and we always are, if these are true, then the home of meaning, the meaning of home, is a very different thing than what we may have thought. As Husserl begins to describe the experience of another alien human being in the fifth Cartesian meditation, and I would return you again to the handout where I quote it, he notes that, quote, a certain immediacy of intentionality must be present here, going out from world, which in any case is the incessantly underlying basis, and making present to consciousness a there too, which nevertheless is not itself there and can never become an itself there. We have here, accordingly, a kind of making co-present, a kind of appresentation. And now I'll explain that quote. We do not recognize the other person by ourselves from our own initiative. We do not simply recognize them because they insist on our recognition, as if in a simple submission to them. Rather, our perception of the other reveals our own intentionality as being involved with mediacy, or with margins. The world, not we, has pulled each of us out of ourselves and toward the other. We are within an unheimlich program where we are there together with each other without being ourselves there. On the margins of our experience, the world has decentered and recentered us. The world has mediated us to each other so that we can be together without being there for each other. Like an echo of, or a law to, the reverberations of the thing's flesh calling to our bodies, like an echo of that, we too, we multiple perceivers, are kept in the realm of being together, mit Dasein, in order to prevent us from becoming hardened like things to each other. We are kept apart, always on the margin of each other, so that the things, perhaps, can keep their fleshly calls, resonances, reverberations within and between us. It is because the other and I are given together as appresentation that the things gather their speed and their momentum. They are fleshly because they are given to both of us. They are things that echo our body because they are not simply our own. The move toward the other in Cartesian meditations expresses Husserl's essence of phenomenology. It shows the active power of world and the way that experience unfolds, always on the margins, always toward the margins. It is toward the other who is with me without being themselves there in me that we are turned. It is with others that we are paired. And thus the things present themselves also as beyond our intentionality and yet motivating and sustaining that same intentionality. Husserl even speaks of the way in which we are forever moving toward one another explicitly. The experience of the other's body, the alien form of a body that means something, that can mean everything to me, is couched in the mood of the subjunctive. He literally says, and I'm not going to read the whole long quote, he literally says, the other brings to mind the way my body would look if I were there. The other person appears in a mode, the mode of the there. They do not appear as themselves there, and yet the mode of appearing is still kept. The mode of the other person's experience is mediated, and it is mediated by my own movement. This movement of mine, as if I were there, reaches into them and has already allowed them to come to me as requiring that we both approach each other on the margins, as if the margins were the very home of the one and the same world that is now always and forever a shared world. In the face of the other, my own motive here, my whole thingliness or body, leaps toward them. I experience the very terms of the other as my own terms on the margins. I see all of you right now, in your little screens, I see you as if I were there. I see varying levels of engagement and boredom and when will this be over and when will the Bible come up? I see all of that, right? Or I think I do. I at least begin to interpret on the basis of seeing myself in your place as if I were there. I see others because I am already on the move toward them, even if I remain standing still right here. The very experience of other people is the experience of being not at home, of being in two places at once. And this Zoom thing, this is like being in 12 places at once. Right? I live there with them and yet remain here. I am in two places and it is almost unbearable. My body lives a life that is not properly its own, in living its own. And I am simultaneously this here and that there. In the face of the other, perception is ecstatic, far too ecstatic, perhaps, for itself by itself. And not only perception is ecstatic, according to Husserl, our whole bodies are. What I witness is the transformation of the German notion of Körper into Leib, and that was in the quote that he used. I see a doubling of my Körper, and within that doubling, the movement towards and on the margin that allows the other person also to demand the sense of live, of lived body. I see the very birth, the doubling of the world in the pairing with the other person. I see world as precisely its plurality within its whole. and I see it as involving my own movement, my own initiative, I have always already left myself subjunctively as if I were there in perceiving other and world. I have always already been betrayed by my own body, which cannot simply live here and still be alive. But this betrayal is also the greatest gift, the greatest facet of givenness. It is the explosion of the world into a world of meaning that can only be meaning because it is not simply my own, not simply a world of things, but of others. The world is also, it is primarily, a sense of movement, present, past, future, and subjunctive. The very possibility of the world is grounded in the subjunctive life on the margins that experience presents as its home away from home. The very impact of temporality is the way in which time intertwines with the immediacy of the world in its giving me out to the other there as if I were. So I have about 4 or 5 more pages on Husserl, and I'm going to kind of condense them a little bit. This last part that I wanted to talk about is how people are within transcendental intersubjectivity mutually internal. Each of us is mutually internal, and how we self-objectify transcendental intersubjectivity. The reason I'm going to compress it is that I want to get to the Bible before too much longer. But I also wanted to tell you that I think, in some sense, this is the most important piece of the lecture, because it's here that we turn from simple explication to the notion of the margin, to on those margins, what is it that other people and I exist to one another as sort of moving toward an absolute. So I'm just going to read a few of the things. I'm not going to read the quote from the crisis, which I think is the last quote from Husserl on the outline, but I am going to read some of the things. It might seem that my way of living as a unity of internal time, as being a self-same ego through the moments of my life, comes before I recognize another person. Certainly, I must already have created a variational mode of myself and been enduring in a self-same way in my own here in order to engage the other person over there. I had to be temporal first, it would seem, because it takes time to get to know the other person. It takes time even to be surprised or threatened or thrilled. But the question is whether these variational modes of myself, my past, present, and future self, can unify themselves on their own without the presence of another person to motivate and sustain them. For the mere presence of variations of myself, I remember my past self and I have more than one, is not sufficient to intuit an essence, a unity of essence, that would allow a coherent higher level intuition, perception of another person, to come about. The mere fact of my variations, present, past, and future self, is not proof of my eidetic ego, so to say. There must be a further act of intuiting, an act through those variations that arises by means of them and yet surpasses them. So what I'm talking about here is how Husserl very often says that there's some sort of structural parallel between my life as a self-unifying temporal being. I'm unifying some sort of alien sense of myself with myself when I have a memory or when I look into the future. And he says that this structure of internal time consciousness maps onto or parallels the structure of my experience of other people. Husserl says that it's in the same way that I constitute myself temporally, as the same subject through time, that I constitute the meaning of the other person. But this in the same way clearly does not mean in an identical way. Rather, I think these are paired. In my own actual sense of my life, my endurance is an original possession. I am already enduring when I meet the other, and you're enduring the lecture, so you know what enduring is. And thus, when I meet her, I can build on and off of my habits, my accomplishments of endurance. Or my endurance in meeting her is enlisted in a new way in order to endure again, in another way, the presence of another person. and endure I must. For I am enlisted as enduring, as temporal variations of the same person through time's flow, in order to perform a self-alienation that would meet the other where she is, without simply categorizing her within my own projects. This self-alienation would not be possible were it not for its structural resonances with my own project of enduring through time. So what I want to argue is that perhaps there is more to this double-paired movement, this in the same way, than meets the eye. Perhaps the movement of endurance through time and the self-alienation that allows for the other and myself to be co-present, perhaps these are literally the reverse sides of the very same motion. Perhaps it is my temporal endurance that is called for by the self-alienation that is initiated in perceiving the other. Perhaps it is my self-alienation that is called for by my temporality. Just as inside and outside are defined primordially through transcendental intentional life, so too it could be that temporality and alterity are equiprimordial. If intentional life is life on the margins, then perhaps I am always marginal even with respect to my own life. Perhaps I endure as the same person because of decentering or depresentation being the very simultaneity of subjectivity with itself. Perhaps I am a whole by means of time because I am not a whole without the other person and the self-alienation that they require. In fact, Husserl does suggest something very much like this when he goes on to talk about the relationship between the transcendental ego and my own personal or human ego. What I am as a human being, what each of us is a self-objectification of the larger whole. What we find in phenomenological self-reflection is that the one doing the reflecting is doing that on behalf of a whole, transcendental intersubjectivity, that objectifies itself. This process of self-objectification is not simple, and it reiterates again just how original the notions of inside and outside are within phenomenological explication. The transcendental subject is what each of us bears within herself or himself. I live my life as this person and as the transcendental subject with which I announce myself as transcendental to others. But the transcendental subject that I announce also has me within it. I live my life here in this actual I, as given over to the whole in which I form one important moment. I have the transcendental in me, and I am in the transcendental. I bear the other within me, and I am born over there as if I were there within that other. There is a mutual internality and a mutual entailment. This bearing within myself of the transcendental subject, and this is a quote from the longer quote I didn't read, the bearing within myself, and all of the co-constituting powers that it employs should remind us of the relation of pairing that Husserl has described in Cartesian Meditations. For this relation of bearing within is etymologically connected in German with the mutual transfer of sense, sinus ubertragung, by which we are claimed together. What I bear within, I also transfer, have already transferred to the other. Bearing is possible because transfer requires it. The freedom to do phenomenology occurs within my actual life. It is this human being who finds and initiates the epoche and the reduction. But its necessity, my having to be this actual person who comes to phenomenology as if to a religious conversion, this is seen only when I reflect on how my actual life is already transferred, entailed, called for, in terms of its sense and not just its essence, by the larger whole that is just on, that just is the margins of my life. The transcendental is the margin of my life. It is a margin call, as it were. And by being on the margins, this transcendental life really is the center of my enduring, expanding, infinite process of co-constituting the world as a method of simple explication. Out of this center, each sentence, each impulse to communicate the meaning of a shared task or world is an absolute beginning. And so we might say that transcendental intersubjectivity, which shows me my own necessity as being this embodied finite being, is what puts me in connection with the divine. If anything about me as this actual person is eternal, it is the way in which the bodily connections between me and others, between me and things, between me and world, are given as the primary motor to our ongoing mutual bearing within and being borne by the transcendental. All right, so I got over the really boring part. So now we'll go on to the Bible. Are you still up for me doing this, or do you want to go home? You're okay. All right. So let's turn to the Bible and attempt to read by ways of simple explication. I hope this might allow us to make a new beginning towards a phenomenology of religion that is neither dogmatic nor insensitive to the history of interpretation. And I hope that we could see how explication is itself a continuation of givenness within a continuously unfolding relation to the divine. So let's look first at Deuteronomy 9 and 10. For it's here that the relation between law and experience, self and other, community and foreigner, home and margin is established. In Deuteronomy chapter 10, Moses speaks about the way in which the Lord commanded him to carve tablets of the law a second time and to make the Ark of the Covenant. Moses does so, then ascends the mountain where God writes on the tablets. This is for the second time, as the previous tablets had been smashed by Moses, though they were written with, quote, the finger of God in chapter 9, because the Israelites, remember, had turned away from the Lord. So there's a beginning again, a new beginning in chapter 10, an absolute beginning, as if the previous beginning, the previous writing by God on the previous set of tablets, were able to be rewritten. And as in all beginnings, but especially in this one, the beginning again of the beginning, the meaning of the beginning, has to be explicated. The laws written by the finger of God are not fully self-explanatory. Clearly, the transgression of the Israelites demonstrated that. And so the life of the Israelites within the covenant with God begins with Moses asking them a question, even though they have the tablets. Quote, so now, O Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you? It's a funny question to ask since he's giving them the tablets. The law, as it is written, is not able to interpret itself. The law is what is given so that the people may come to themselves as a people around it, with it, but not solely, not sufficiently, because of it. The law continues to give itself in the absolute beginnings of each simple explication. Moses, in fact, does not give the commandments in his answer to the question he asks the community. Instead, Moses explicates the meaning of the law. He participates in the continuation of the givenness that God institutes by means of giving to the people a set of, quote, decrees that are for their own well-being. That's what it says. So God's law is therefore not just a law of exclusion and compulsion, not simply a priori. God's law is a law that requires of the Israelites further decrees, further enactments of a series of perceptions, who and what God is, who and what they are, and who or what their responsibilities entail. To live within the covenant, one must perceive according to the possibilities opened up by the finger of God. And the finger of God does not just write, it points. So it is noteworthy here to find God described by Moses within the story of the covenant as the God, quote, who executes justice for the orphan and the widow, and who loves the strangers, providing them food and clothing, end quote. This is not a God who is solely rule-bound, solely at home only with the chosen ones. This God is not a God who moves away from the margins toward the center. This is a God who not only tolerates, but who loves those on the margins of the center and those on the margins of the margins. This is a God who loves widows and orphans and strangers. This is a God who dwells wherever there is a need for justice, for bodily support, for care that would arise out of suffering, loss, and failure to integrate. at the very center of Jewish law and Jewish life then. At the heart of the story of the covenant arises a command about perception. Quote, you shall also love the stranger, for you were strangers in the land of Egypt. To be within a covenant with, a commitment to, a community with the divine is to participate in divine action. And it is to participate first and foremost by way of a mutual perception. Over there, where the stranger is at least the memory of the enduring and the self-alienation that I was, that I would be, as if I were still there in Egypt, in the situation of my being on the margins. My ability to participate in the divine act, to read the writing of the finger of God as if written with my own finger, my ability to do that rests on my being referred, first by the prophet, and then by my own perception, my own love to the other person. If I cannot love the stranger, and by doing so recollect, remember, and give new meaning to my own history of being a stranger to others, then I cannot be with God. This covenant I enter into, this is a way of seeing. And it's neither simply creative nor simply submissive. It is an absolutely new beginning, one that takes on my history and the history of those with whom I identify and recasts it according to a simple explication of what the divine itself attends to. Such a shift in the way of seeing, in the ability to love on the margins, is not only a command. In the context of a covenant, it is a promise. Quote, your ancestors went down to Egypt 70 persons, and now the Lord your God has made you as numerous as the stars in heaven. What allows a community to grow is not only the enduring, but the embrace of the role of alienation, of strangeness, of the alien. It is because I am part of an alienated group, because I suffer alienation from myself and from the divine even, that I am handed over to all the stars in the heavens, to each person who, like me, lives on the margins. The promise of the law is not bondage, but the ability to identify with all those whom I both see and cannot see. Just as I cannot take all the stars of the sky into my grasp at once, just as there are more around the edges of my field of vision, so too there are always more with me on the margins, more who call forth a perception of loving exchange, of mutual internality. And it will always be a call, this covenant, this perceptual shift, because there will always be more, always be another manner of givenness of the alien or the stranger. If it were not this way, there would not need to be a command. There would not need to be further directives. But tragedy is always what we suffer, and loss is always on the horizon, always moving toward and within the present. For there will always be the poor, the widows, the orphans, and the strangers. And the community in its actual life will never succeed in reducing the margins to itself. And thus we are called to act on behalf of the whole that will always fail. That will always fail to be what it ought to be. And we are called to live in a more authentic perception there on the margins, or as if we were there on the margins throughout the life within the covenant. God does no less. God has done no less. Were we not on the margins in Egypt, if we were not strangers, would God have come for us? This is what we can never answer, and it probably is something we can never ask. We must only act as if there were a necessity to our apparently contingent alienation, as if there were a necessity to our tragedy and loss. And we must answer as if we were the ones called to address tragedy and loss as the very essence of our life, of our perception, of our law. Let's now look at Matthew 25, the story of the final judgment. And here we find again the commandment, which is again couched in terms of perception, to live on and toward the margins. Here Jesus casts what people will have already done in terms of their ability to perceive or not perceive him, within their acts for others on the margin. Those sheep who have fed him, given him something to drink, welcomed him as a stranger, visited him in prison, those will have everlasting life. But the sheep will not have known the divine in their acts of mercy. Quote, when was it we saw you a stranger and welcomed you? The reward does not come from their correctly perceiving the divine in the guise of the human. Their reward is not that of Balchus and Philemon from ancient Greek. The reward is for seeing the human as the human, as the very ground of ethics all unto themselves. Quote, just as you did it to the least of these who are members of my family, you did it to me. The stranger must be perceived as a member of the family. The family must transcend its fear of strangers. And so the margin, the prison, the institutions and persons who seem so obviously to be rejected, these are as much part of the mutual internality of God as the character of family, as those whom in the natural attitude we might call mothers or siblings. But this means that Jesus, that the divine, rewards on the basis of responding to embodied other people and their sufferings as the necessary moments of a more intimate, more sophisticated act of meaning. People are the events of meaning precisely at the margins because it requires us not only to see ourselves there as if we were there, but because it requires us to see everyone there. All human bodies, even the divine. It is not simply that I am paired with the prisoner as if I were there, but in acting out of that perception, which is truly important, I also create the trace of the more fundamental perception as if God were there. This consciousness of God in the other is not necessarily an aspect of my self-consciousness. It is perhaps a passive synthesis of myself and the other within a larger, perhaps transcendental relationship. But that relationship has a life of its own, and it communicates with, it opens on to the divine, just as surely as the failure to perceive on and according to the margins closes off our perceptions of the divine. For in Jesus's repetition of the same set of acts to the goats, we know that the love of the stranger, of those on the margins, is again the center of the relation to the divine. And claiming not to be fully self-conscious about the implications of one's perceptions will not be a defense. Perceptions always already occur, and they call out, they demand to be explicated and reflected upon. Perceptions are always within an as structure. Thus, we are entrusted to the margins, and they will always help us to acquire further reflection. Because the margins are the place in which the as structure appears as a life of education. It is there on the margins with the stranger that we can do a phenomenology of our religious and moral lives. Quote, truly I tell you, just as you did not do it to one of the least of these, you did not do it to me. Despite the apocalyptic tone of Jesus in his speaking to the goats, it would seem in Matthew 25, everyone has reason to hope. For the expansion, the explication of perceptions can in fact be given over to the explication of the divine within the human. Jesus' attempt to point this out twice inaugurates another absolute beginning. If there were a failure to follow the finger of God from Deuteronomy to Matthew, if that happened, then it can be addressed, redressed. The tablets can be rewritten by the finger of God. And we can live a life on the margins where the perception and action together, paired with the stranger, can reverberate back toward a moral salvific time, not just of enduring alienation, but of celebrating love. But even given that hope, everyone also has reason to fear. For who among us has not left at least one of the least of these there on the margin without enacting, without explicating, the mutual internality of the family of the divine? Who has not left a refugee at the border, a child in a bombing raid? We have all failed from the beginning to move perception into hospitality, for we have had to see what comes to us according to the very limits of its manner of givenness. And we are not always given the stranger as the stranger. We are caught, even on the margins, in social modes of concealment and reduction. And simple explication cannot tolerate reduction. But we are directed, we are oriented, and we can become reoriented. All it takes is to follow the finger of God toward what that finger points at. And if we continue reading the Bible, I think we'll find it does not simply point to the tablet God has written. It points also towards the margins, both those on which we have lived and those on which the stranger, the alien, lives. It points in two directions at once. God's ambiguous in that way. And thus it, the finger of God, forces us to account for our lives by means of what we are able to see or to constitute within our perception of each other. And out of that seeing, and only out of that seeing, what we can accomplish as intertwining with the mutual internality that we bear, is it possible? So let's turn to two women, Ruth and Esther. Is that okay? You still up for this? Can I still talk about Ruth and Esther? It's like the whole point. I now get to the point like 3 hours later, right? These women are strange. They are strange because they appear, they speak, and they accomplish in ways that surpass most of the men in the entire Bible. They are strange because they are bound within a situation in which they are literally strangers to those to whom they relate. Each of these women take up a relation of an alien to a home, and each by means of that enlarges what the divine, what faith, and what community means. So first, Ruth. Ruth was a Moabite. The ancestor of David, of Jesus, was not a Jew. She was a stranger to the Jews, and she came to know Jews because of her husband and her mother-in-law, who were themselves strangers in Moab. Ruth loved Naomi, her mother-in-law, even after Ruth's husband died. Ruth loved, in Naomi, a strange woman. And she attests to this when she makes her move and says, "Your people shall be my people, your God, my God." That's quite a move. Nevertheless, she and Naomi walk as two poor, strange women back to Bethlehem, of all places. It's amazing how far that was. Two women on the road, no money. God knows how they got there. They brave the life of the margin, harmful as it often is to women, together. They are desperately poor together and live off the gleanings of the fields. When Naomi, as a widow, is not provided for by the Jews, by her own people, Ruth steps in. And because of Ruth's love of the stranger in her home, she finds that she too can be loved as a foreigner. Ruth, in fact, asks Boaz, who Naomi wishes to marry Ruth, quote, "Why have I found favor in your sight that you should take notice of me when I am a foreigner?" And Boaz replies to Ruth in a way that should be familiar to us now, that it is because of, quote, "all that you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband." For Boaz, what matters is the manner in which Ruth, quote, "left your father and mother in your native land and came to a people that you did not know before." It was the love that structured Ruth's actions, and as such, she became a stranger who embodied the law in her strangeness, who thus could not be ignored, concealed, or discarded. Esther is even stranger than Ruth. Esther begins her story by hiding her Jewishness. She begins as a concubine, but in doing so, and being a stranger who hides her strangeness in a foreign land, she is persuaded to save strangers in that land by Mordecai. This woman is told not to keep silence, but to work by means of her body, her voice, her intelligence, her simple explications, to free the strangers who are her people and to live a life by which the margins become relevant to the center. Mordecai's most important persuasive argument is this, quote, "Who knows? Perhaps you have come to royal dignity for just such a time as this." The necessity of Esther's body, of her human life, is thus within her self-objectification as an equal member of the divine, of her community, of the kingdom. She is Esther, but she is also the mutual internality of each to the other. Hence, she requests of Mordecai that he, quote, gather all the Jews to be found in Susa and hold a fast on my behalf. I and my maids will also fast as you do. Within the practice of this fast together on behalf of one another, Esther becomes able to approach the king, to take control, and even, perhaps, to write the law. This last is very strange, that a woman of this time could write with her own finger the law that would save the Jews and inaugurate a new festival in the Jewish tradition, Purim. And yet there it is. Queen Esther, quote, gave full written authority, confirming this second letter about Purim. There is a new beginning then for every simple explication. It is accomplished precisely by someone on the margins who announces her marginality and then holds on to the legitimacy of the margin as the origin of responsibility. Let's turn away finally from Ruth and Esther to one final woman. Perhaps her name is Mary Magdalene. She shows up in the Gospel of John. For there, on the margins of the Christian community, on the margins of the city, stands a woman who is first to encounter the risen Jesus. It is as this marginal figure that she receives the command to allow the margins their room, to follow the move to the margins with her perception, and to live there on the margin as the rightful place of the divine. When Mary is confronted by the angels at Jesus' tomb, confronted because she is weeping, she says, quote, they have taken away my Lord, I do not know where they have laid him. This woman who is on the margins of the city, at the edge of life and death, is looking for someone, for something, that is not immediately apparent. She attributes causality, quote, they have taken away, without evidence. This failure of Mary's to perceive correctly the absence of Jesus leads immediately to her failure to perceive his presence. He confronts her about her weeping. Well, no one let a grieving person grieve. And she shifts her misperception toward Jesus. Perhaps he is a gardener. Perhaps he has taken Jesus away. This misperception is something that Jesus counters simply by addressing her, Mary. And then in the address, Mary recognizes and embraces him. For some reason, her embrace elicits this response from Jesus. Quote, do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God. What does this mean, the injunction not to hold on to Jesus? It means that Mary continues to misperceive, to love in such a way as to prevent the movement to the margins that the divine calls for. Jesus is on the way elsewhere. His enduring is passing over into his move toward the margin. His externality is passing over into the mutual internality of all persons, his brothers and sisters in the divine. Jesus is the self-objectification of the divine as the unifier of all those who would trace out their subjectivity, their embodied life. And he is this self-objectification precisely as revealing and concealing both at the same time. Jesus reveals himself as the one who must always be transferred elsewhere, who must be transitioning toward another movement. Jesus reveals the trajectory of subjectivity to be not simply within the actual person, but within the larger relationship of subjectivity to itself by means of leaving behind, moving to the margins of perceptibility. Jesus is the human and the divine bound together towards the margin. Neither Mary, nor the brothers, nor anyone else can bind Jesus into dogmatic certainty. Each simple explication, like the one Mary is enjoined to do on Jesus' behalf, is an absolute beginning. It is a reformation of perception. Perception as intentional, as bound up with the other in an intimate burst of recognition, does not codify, does not reify, does not make static what we are to one another and what we are within ourselves. perception rather announces the going of the divine, the arriving of the divine, as always already happening on the margins. We are at and in the things when we perceive, but just as much are we at and in the horizons that they refer to, that they bear within themselves. We are with the others for whom we exceed, for whom we move out of ourselves. But by being with them, we cannot but be reminded that we are temporal, that we are passing into and out of a togetherness that must each day be refashioned, relearned, resettled, re-explicated. The simple explication is that the one whom Mary embraces, the one whom Mary follows, like Ruth following Naomi, must never be co-opted into a system of recognition of hermeneutics that is finished once and for all. Rather, any utterance of action, even that of Jesus, must be oriented towards a hermeneutics that always strives toward a teleological whole that involves all of us, but not clearly, not without more work to be done. If phenomenology is a set of infinite tasks, as Husserl said it was, if phenomenology is hospitality, as Derrida says it was, if phenomenology is the perception of the face, as Levinas said it was, if phenomenology is simple explication that inaugurates an absolute beginning in every statement, then a phenomenology of religion cannot be anything more than an attempt to read the text into oneself and to read oneself into the text by means of the alterity, the strangeness, that is the very motor of reading as such. Thank you.
Peter, thank you so much. So we now have time for questions, and I have several pages of questions. But sure. Who would like to ask a question? It's an open floor. Please remember to unmute your mic when you're asking a question. Okay.
And I really encourage anyone to ask. Students, faculty, people from abroad. Hi, Smiljana. Nice to see you, Catherine, John. Anybody can ask.
I may begin then while everybody is collecting their thoughts. I have two questions to begin with, Peter. Where is ecstasis in all of this? Because I was following you very clearly, and I mean, I can see ecstasis in certain horizon, but other than that, it's a completely full being. I don't have any space where it can become ecstatic. Mm-hmm. That's number one. And number two, which is a connected question, where would you place freedom in the continuum that you described?
Those are very helpful questions. And I don't know that I'll have a very good answer, but I'll try to answer it. So the way I think of ecstasis, like literally standing outside of myself, right? The sense in which I'm never fully present or never fully at home. I think that ecstasis plays an important role in the way in which the margins call me out of myself towards them. So ecstasis is the way in which I follow the thing and follow the other, and the way in which I'm already as if I were there in two places at once. But I think your question is sort of, so why isn't ecstasis more the one that sets the terms? And I think ecstasis and what I'm saying is situated by the larger whole. And so it's sort of contained ecstasis, as it were. Ecstasis.
My feeling that there is no being in ecstasis. It's a certain, it's like a function of a certain maybe horizon or certain condition, but not foundationally ontological.
And I think that's what I'm actually trying to say, is that the ecstasis could not be founding itself, but rather it expresses how it needs to be founded within the community, within the others towards which it's oriented. So there is no self-founding. And ecstasis is, in fact, the expression of that, that being is not something rooted in me, but it's rooted in us and then in me by means of addressing the others. Okay. I'm sorry, I forget your second question.
Freedom.
Freedom. So in a certain sense, we don't have a choice. We are already on the margins. We're already living toward the margins. And the choice simply comes in how we are going to take a stand on the marginality of our intentional life. But you're right. There it doesn't, just like it doesn't start in being, it doesn't start in freedom. It starts in already being immersed or entwined in a situation. And freedom comes out of that situation back towards me. That is, what am I now going to do with this?
Let me suggest something, and then that will be probably, I'll stop there after the suggestion. We have a power, a mental power of inhibiting intentional consciousness. So as Husserl moves towards Erlebnis, in a sense, in liberating or, intentional consciousness, one can, imagine the reduction going in the opposite way, is what would the world like? I mean, Eastern philosophies, many of them, they actually, their telos is towards inhibiting intentional consciousness. So what does it mean? What happens? What is it? What's taking place in inhibiting intentional consciousness? What's the meaning of it? And where would you place life as it happens outside of intentional consciousness?
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, certainly religions have an answer to what inhibits intentionality in the explicit self-aware way, right? So they would talk about sin, or they would talk about...
I completely didn't think about it, It's interesting, yeah.
But I do think that what what I was trying to say, there is a preview. The thing has already viewed us. The other has already drawn us out of ourselves before we can actually reflect on it. So Merleau-Ponty often says this, that, bodily intentionality is lived before being reflected on. And so therefore, in a sense, we're already steps beyond ourselves. So the pre-intentional life, in a way, founds intentional life. But I don't think that's what you mean. I think you mean currents in us that resist intentionality. Is that right?
An Unrian understanding, Unrian project will be to reformulate the whole of understanding of consciousness as non-intentional in its primeval sense, and non-intentional as secondary.
I mean, I think if I were being Husserlian, I think what I would have to say is that everything is preparation for intentionality, and even the things which conceal or resist intentionality do so in a way that opens the very effort that they take to an intentional criticism. But maybe you and I can talk more about this, because I'd like to know a little bit more about...
I would like to hear from Jing, actually, because she studies Buddhism, and as I understand, Yogacara consciousness is primarily non-intentional, but so maybe three of us will have a chance at ICNAP, talk about it. Okay, well, please, the floor is open, and let's use this possibility. The question, the talk was so rich that there are so many different directions that we can go in asking Peter questions. Use this possibility.
And feel free to take me to task, too. I know Chrissy Rozewicz should have some things to say, and Annie can have some things to say too, and Catherine. They all know phenomenology, and John Allard. But anybody, you can disagree with me or tell me I don't know my stuff. That's fine too.
And those who do not know phenomenology are welcome to ask.
That's right. Anybody.
Mm-hmm. Phenomenology should be able to withstand non-phenomenological questioning. Otherwise, what's the point?
Absolutely.
Yeah. I do actually have a question for you about what you were saying about hospitality and the stranger. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, I don't know who's speaking, okay. But I hear you.
Oh, it's Christine.
Oh, hi.
Yes, I wanted to ask you about this notion of Homeric hospitality, where the whole point of hospitality for the ancient Greeks was that a god could show up in any form.
That's right.
Any stranger could be a god, and hence the need for hospitality. And I'm wondering if you see any room for this in a Husserlian intentionality, or St. Paul, when he's talking to the Athenians, says about the temple of the unknown god. You know, this is your room for the Christian god here. So is there room for this in Husserlian intentionality, especially what you're saying in intersubjectivity? Can you speak to that point at all?
I'll try. I want to ask you one quick question about ancient Greek hospitality. The gift that is exchanged in Greek hospitality, isn't there like a really important exchange of gifts?
It solidifies the bond of host and guest. And I know there's more to it than I can think of right now. Do you have anything in mind about the gift?
No, I'm thinking about how the kind of imposition of exchange in hospitality, both of the host and of the guest in ancient Greek culture, reminds me of the kind of thing that the noema and then the other person elicits. It's almost like, so yes, I think Husserl would have a lot to offer a sort of reconnection with ancient Greek notions of hospitality, because I do think it's the thing in the other person that calls us to phenomenology. Other people don't think this. You know, I think when I read The Crisis of the European Sciences that he's basically arguing we are brought to phenomenology and to the epoche and to the reductions by means of conflict, that there is something that can trigger us in our reflections. I think just like that, I think his discussion of pairing means that the other person triggers in us a necessary movement towards them. And so the reason I was asking about the gifts is I think givenness in Husserl really does echo gift-giving and responsive gift-giving and responsible gift-giving. And so I think that phenomenology can only be done in a community of people who view each other as having a wealth of things to offer. So, you know, it's not a surprise to me that you developed in your way of reading and of thinking about philosophy to going to graduate school, and you're going to get a PhD, and you're going to do all these other things, because what I saw when I had class with you was just this kind of insight, these kinds of questions that you're asking. And so you sort of spurred me to do more work in order to answer more effectively the things that you were asking and interested in. And that's just me being honest, right? And so but that's true about anybody. The other person is always going to elicit our capacity to reckon with them. And in Husserl, reckoning with means paying attention to manners of givenness and then responding as those manners dictate. And so I think in Greek hospitality, there's often an exchange of stories. I remember Odysseus coming into a banquet and him being sort of required to give a story. And so I think that if that's what Greek hospitality is, the requirement of stories, and that shows up, I think, in Plato as well, with Socrates sort of, you know, feeling like he's owing his hosts a story. I think that notion of story parallels very nicely the notion of explication and how explication can only be done together.
Thank you.
Sure, that was a nice question.
Am I the only one that can't hear?
I heard you. I don't know. I heard some of what you were saying. Olga, you need to turn off your, or turn on your mic, Olga.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Yes. Okay.
Thank you. Right.
Thank you. Okay. I have on chat, on the chat here, on the chat screen, I have a question from Annie Nolan, and I will read it out loud because she actually asks for this. So she says, thank you for the talk, Dr. Costello. I'm watching from the library, so I cannot talk out loud, sorry. But could you explain a little more about the margin? I know we have talked about this idea in our class, bracketing, but I'm just not really familiar with this word in Husserl. Is it like the par ergon?
Thank you, Annie. That's a great question, and I'm glad you're in the library. That's good. Although I'm sad. So, Annie, you really zeroed in. You and Christine both have done an excellent job of zeroing in on the heart of the talk. Husserl doesn't talk about the word margin, so it's not. It's not clear that what I'm saying is actually really Husserlian phenomenology, since he doesn't actually mention it. I think what I'm trying to do is push him towards a kind of responsive hospitality by means of identifying in his work what he does talk about, but to me intimates the margin. And one thing that he does talk about that we have talked about in class is horizon. And I think horizon really gets at what I mean for him to be talking about in terms of margin. The horizon is this the way in which the thing refers beyond itself and to all the references to all the other things or to the situation or to the other people. And so I guess the question that I'm trying to ask myself, and I'm only thinking about this as a response to your question, so I'm grateful to you for that. Where is the horizon? And I guess the margin would be the answer to where the horizon is. It's outside the thing and inside the thing. It's outside of my perception and in my perception. I exist in it and yet not fully within it. So that's how I would say. And I think, yes, Derrida's notion of par ergon, and ergon within his Truth and Painting book, when he talks about Kant's Critique of Judgment, that notion of par ergon is really important. And it is also the margins, like the frame around the picture, the margins. And so, yes, I guess I hadn't noticed that I'm being affected by Derrida's notion of par ergon, but I think I am. So I really, that's good, Annie.
Okay.
I have a question. This is Gordon.
Yes. Hi, Gordon.
At the very beginning, you said a conception arises out of perception.
Yes.
If I recall right?
Yes. That's right.
In Idean section 24, volume 1. It just, if I've got that right.
Yes.
The principles. Okay. What about conception of abstractions? What's the nature of the perception prior to working with abstractions?
So that's an excellent question. I'll try to answer you by way of talking about The Origin of Geometry, which is a later work by Husserl that usually is included with The Crisis, which is one of his last published works. Husserl makes the comment that geometry, which deals largely with abstraction, arises when people have a need. And they needed to do land surveying in order to divide land appropriately. And so they took this very bumpy, very uneven thing that we're going to call the life world, and they discovered in it that it sustained and sort of generated out of itself notions of straight, of line, of plane, all those things. And so it seems like even abstractions arise out of experience, and out of experience meaning more than it seems to mean in its immediate self-presentation. So experience carries within it the weight to pursue within it its links to other resources, abstractions being one of those. I take Merleau-Ponty's phenomenology of perception to be showing this as well, that in some sense, every abstraction that we have arises out of sort of the overwhelmingly concrete character of existence in which both abstraction and concretion are simultaneous.
Thanks.
Yeah, that was a great question.
Okay, I have one more question from Catherine Doyle.
Sure.
Also on chat. So Catherine, I'm going now. I see you. I can see you. So I'm going now to read your question. Yeah. Hi, Dr. Costello. I'm also in the quiet study area and cannot talk out loud, but I was wondering if you could speak to how Edith Stein's discussion on empathy that we studied in class relates to the idea of the margin. Thank you. Okay.
Another excellent question. Catherine, thank you very much, all of you, for thinking of these very challenging questions. And now I'm just sort of like buying time to figure out how I'm going to answer this excellent thing that Catherine has asked. So I think that when Stein talks about empathy, what she's trying to do is make Husserl's discussion of pairing and intersubjectivity much more concrete and much more evidently rooted in the perception of the body of the other person. And so when she does that, what I think we experience in ourselves, and I think Stein would agree, is that we experience ourselves, going back to Olga's terms, becoming ecstatic, living both in my experience of the other person and in her experience of herself and in her experience of me. So I almost become divided while I'm being united. And so I begin to live on the margins of myself and of myself and her. So her example in what we read for the course was of a grief. So a military unit loses its leader. And I can feel grief on behalf of the whole unit, and I can feel my own grief. And I can look at another member of the unit and see her grief as relevant to mine, but as not mine, as also of the whole, and yet of the whole in her particular way. And so suddenly I have these shared experiences. That's what Stein is really getting at. Empathy is a shared experience of ours, but it's a shared experience that keeps the distinction between primordial and non-primordial experience open and relevant. So really, empathy, as she says, is a sui generis mode of perceiving. And that means that it isn't just mine. It has its own agency, and it will forever bring home to me that I live with other people in a certain way, in a way of not being fully at home with myself, not being fully at home with them, but somehow in not being at home, still making important integral internal links with them. So I absolutely think that Edith Stein is trying to name this way of a seamless, thoroughly continuous mode of experience, which is nevertheless not quite simply at home with me and with you. So that's great. And I appreciate the question.
Okay. I have one more question on the chat screen. And I think time-wise, this will be our last question, unless somebody comes up with something really burning. So this is from Jing Jing Lee, and she says, somehow my mic doesn't work. Sorry, I note that in the talk, Peter used several terms to describe our relation with others. For example, the others, they cause us to do phenomenology. It's a quote from your presentation, Peter, or also quote, the others are the trigger, quote closed. Indeed, this touches the question of self-identity. We build on our identity always in struggle with others. In Buddhism, this self-other dynamics is referred to as dependent arising. Yet I'm wondering how the self-other dialectics is related to the empirical ego and transcendental ego binary. Thanks. Peter, you should be able to see it on your own chat screen. Yes. Okay, all right.
So thank you, Jingjing. That's a great question. I don't know much about Buddhism, to be completely honest, so I don't know how to respond to the dependent arising, although I'm very interested in it. And it seems like I could learn a lot from you, especially up in ICNAP when we go together. That would be wonderful. I haven't thought about this completely, but I think that perhaps what I'm trying to articulate and what I think Husserl is trying to articulate is that dialectic doesn't quite name what it is that he thinks we experience in the relation of self and other. That is, there's a certain thing that Catherine was asking about in terms of empathy. The co-givenness is in a way a kind of support. We're not striving and struggling simply. We are doing that, but we're not simply doing that. We are actually and actively co-given together in ways that underlie every sort of dependent or interdependent arising. So we do have a shared grieving or a shared joy or something like that. And so the second part of your question, I think Husserl is reluctant to make a claim that the empirical ego and the transcendental ego are simply an either-or proposition. I think what he's trying to do is show us that we have an experience of their unity and of their resistance or, again, going back to Olga, like their covering over or their concealment of one another. And so I think what he emphasizes in a way is their togetherness so as to prevent us from simply thinking about them as binaries. On the other hand, what people fault him for often is that he hasn't done enough to alleviate the binary concerns. So I guess what I would say is this, in talking about the margins as I've done, what I'm trying to do is suggest that there is a way in which Husserl is presenting horizon, marginality, co-givenness as a way that addresses the very question you're asking.
She is writing, exactly, can't agree more. Thanks, Peter.
Well, that's good. I want to apologize to everyone that I took too long to allow for more questions, but I really thought your questions were excellent. And Olga and the Society, I'm very, very grateful for the chance to do this. And it was very nice, Chrissy and Annie and Catherine and John, all those people who logged on from my home institution and from your places so that I could see you as I'm doing it. So thank you very, very much. You made it very fun for me. And Gordon,
is it possible to receive that handout?
Absolutely. I can give you a copy of the lecture also, whatever you would like. Olga, you may give my permission to pass it on to whoever.
Okay. Thank you. Peter, I personally would like to invite you to be here anytime you wish in our forum. And this is also for everybody. Part of the intention behind putting together the society is to create the forum for dialogue and discussion of developing research projects, the nascent research, rather than being in the situation where it has to be published when all the ideas are already clarified more or less, or you have to wait for 2 years to biennial conference happens or something like this. So please come back whenever you are ready with the next step. And also, I'd like to announce that in 2 weeks, we are beginning our emerging scholar series. And this will be Sam Mikey from San Francisco University, which is a Jesuit school, talking about epoche. And he is doing a comparative analysis of epoche in different thinkers in phenomenology. So that's in 2 weeks. And then we have our reading group continuing, preparing for Jonas Taipale lecture. So thank you, everybody. I'm now saving the recording. Please be in touch either on the our listserv or individually. I think that all emails of all participants can be made available for exchange. And the recording will be uploaded on Sophere website probably in a day or two, also available to listen.
Thank you all very, very much. I appreciate all of your time. You spent far too much time on this.
It's perfect.
It's just right.
Yes. Thank you.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Have a good weekend.
You too. Bye.
Bye-bye.